This Corvette is a great car. It's amazing to look at. It has fantastic engineering pedigree. And Mike says it even drives pretty well, but it's by no means a finished car. It's still very much in the process of restoration, and we have a long way to go before this American icon is where it needs to be.
First job is to check how well the engine is running.
Now, Mike did mention this engine was running a little bit rough. It does sound like it's not really running on all eight cylinders. Before I get worried about kind of anything really scary deep in the engine, I'm just going to try all the obvious stuff first.
So let's have a look at the ignition system. I'm fitting new spark plugs, which should be an easy job, but in the Corvette, some are hard to get to, and it takes me over an hour. At the same time, I replace the HT leads, as worn-out leads can cause arcing and therefore misfires.
Well, it does sound a little bit smoother, but it's still not quite there, so I think perhaps some more work is required.
With the plugs and leads changed, I know they aren't the problem. So the next thing to look at is the source of the ignition system, the distributor.
I'm just having a quick look in the distributor cap, because you can get misfires caused by a buildup of deposits and therefore a bad spark actually on each of these terminals. And you've got the rotor arm down here distributing the spark to each of the cylinders at the right time. You can see they're actually looking a little bit dirty. I've seen worse, but certainly this cap should be changed. Now, something else I've noticed is down here, there seems to be some kind of drive cable. It's a bit like a speedo, but actually, because it's connected to the distributor, it's actually going to be for the rev counter.
The cable should be connected to the distributor, but it isn't. So I'm going to take the distributor out of the car and see what's going on. Once I remove the central shaft, it's clear that the gear that drives the rev counter is badly worn. And as the gear is part of the dizzy shaft itself, the whole shaft will have to be replaced. The drive for the end of the rev counter cable is also missing, so I need one of those too. Time to get some new parts.
Now, I haven't gone for just the shaft, I've gone for a few other bits and pieces, including the new dizzy cap, because of course it makes sense to refurb everything while I'm at this stage.
Now all I need to do is lubricate the new distributor parts and put everything back together. Feeler gauge helps check the end float, which can be adjusted with various washers.
So I've now got our new shaft into the body of the dizzy, so it's time for the points. But rather than actually put the original points back in, which do tend to corrode after time, I'm actually going to put in an electronic system, which means you never have to change the points ever again. Very cool.
The new electronic ignition system screws into the distributor in place of the mechanical points and takes over the job of sending electrical pulses to the spark plugs. And because it's transistor-based and doesn't have any moving parts, it should be much more reliable. So far, I've spent £220, a pretty reasonable price to have our beautiful Corvette running how it should. Let's see if it's done the trick.
Well, that sounds a lot smoother already, but I now have to actually set the timing using a strobe light.
With the engine running, the strobe will reveal whether the ignition is firing too soon or too late. I can change it by rotating the body of the dizzy. All I need to do is twist it until the timing shows 18 degrees of advance, as per the manual. Then I tighten the distributor cap, replace the air filter, and everything should be just right.
Well, you can hear it's better straight away. Now, when this car would have come out of the factory, it would have been producing about 300 horsepower, but inevitably, over the years, some of those horses have obviously gone a bit missing. But now we've refurbished and renewed our ignition system, we've almost certainly managed to get most of those horses back into the stable. Now, Mike was complaining that the brakes on our Corvette were rather snatchy and would kind of pull off to the left or the right under braking. That's obviously quite dangerous. Now, rather than going for a test drive to find out exactly what's going on, it seems to be much more sensible to come to a local MOT station where I can use their brake testing machine.
The brake rollers can accurately measure the torque or turning force applied by the brakes at each wheel.
So 187, not bad.
By looking at the figures, I can see exactly where our braking problem lies, and it doesn't seem to be at the back of the car.
And on the right side, we've got 186, which is pretty good. So it's almost exactly spot on the back. So let's try the front. Right, so handbrake on. 256. Let's try the right-hand side. 148, that's really bad. Now, if I do them both at the same time, I'll get like a percentage difference. Okay, so that's showing 53%. Now, the legal maximum discrepancy between one side and the other in this country is 25%, so we're over double that, which means something definitely has to be sorted.
The right-hand brake isn't providing as much brake force as the left. The question is, why? I need to take the car back to the workshop to find out. As the brakes are drum brakes rather than discs, I need to open them up to see what's really going on.
Everything looks pretty much brand new. Got a new slave cylinder, all the springs have got no corrosion on them whatsoever. The shoes have got loads of meat on the friction material as well. I can't see any leaks or anything, so everything seems like it's in order. One thing I will check is this clever little mechanism down here, which basically takes up the slack, obviously, when you're operating your brakes or using up the friction material. And if I just operate this little lever here, you can see that when this is pulled up, in turn, kind of moves this little wheel down the bottom, this little cog, and that, in turn, actually separates the shoes, so it kind of compensates for any loss of friction material. And that's all working as well, so really, there doesn't seem to be anything wrong with this side, so maybe something wrong with the other side.
And the right-hand front brake is in just as good condition as the left. Even the self-adjuster is working as it should.
So really, the only thing that could be wrong with these brakes is some kind of imbalance in the adjustment. So all I have to do now is put everything back together again and hope that just setting them up exactly the same is going to be enough to make this car work okay.
The effective braking force can be adjusted so both sides are evenly matched. That way, neither brake will snatch, which would pull the car to one side.
So I've now got the shoes on both sides, kind of just touching the drums when I put them into position. So what I want to do now is center those shoes. I'm just going to pump the brakes a few times and then just check that they're all kind of free and moving around nicely. And then I want to try and find out if I can get them exactly the same amount of adjustment.
I'm going to use a nifty tool to apply a constant pressure to the brake pedal. That way, the brakes are going to be lightly applied, which will mean that the brake shoes are rubbing on the inside of the drum, and I'll be able to feel whether the resistance on either side is the same and can adjust accordingly.
So the brakes are now on, and there's quite a bit of drag on there. Let's try the other side. That's just a little bit less, a tiny adjustment required.
Using a screwdriver, I can push the self-adjusting ratchet downwards, which in turn forces the brake shoes outwards, increasing the braking effect. By making this adjustment, I can make sure both left and right sides are providing an equal braking force. So it's back to the MOT centre and the brake testing machine.
OK, I'm going to go straight onto the imbalance. Let's have a look. Right. That's pretty good. I'll just try one more time just to be sure. Even better. Can't be happier than that. Well, sorting out the brakes has hardly cost me an arm and a leg, but of course that's mostly down to the fact that all the parts are pretty much brand new. But that tiny little adjustment has made all the difference between a terrifying drive and a lovely, enjoyable cruise.
Click here to subscribe.